Well, good morning, everybody.
Oh, we're starting.
As we're going through this morning, we're so excited for you all to be with us, excited for you to join us as we got party music going. So glad that we can be here as we're learning through this series on the seven fatal distractions. Today we're going to be talking about envy. And so as we're going through this morning, I think one of the recognitions that we can understand is that to combat envious nature, to combat jealousy, to combat these things, we need to recognize what God has given us and how we can be content through His grace. So if you would, let's stand together as we sing this song this morning.
Great is your faithfulness, O God. You wrestle with the sinner's heart. You lead us by still waters into mercy. And nothing can keep us apart. God, you use the weak to lead the strong. You lead us in the song of your salvation, and all your people sing along. So
that we can trust that His grace is sufficient. And as we go through this morning, I'm so excited for an opportunity to worship our Lord and recognize how we can lean into His grace and recognize all of the blessings that He has for our lives. And you can be seated for just a moment as we go through a few announcements. One thing that I wanted to make you all aware of is inside of your bulletin, you'll see a lot of that upcoming information. One of the things that I wanted to draw special attention to today is that we do have a BCC 101 orientation coming up next week. If you're new to the church and want to find out more about what our church is all about, We would love for you to be a part of that. There is childcare available, and we serve a complimentary pizza lunch as we talk through some of those core beliefs of Batesville Christian Church. And so we would love for you to be a part of that. You can check the box on the connection card, or you can call the church office to RSVP. And if you would take the time to fill out that connection card, you can tear it off, drop it in the offering box right by the double doors on your way out. And we would love to know that you're here. Inside of that, you'll also see the capability of, again, writing down prayer requests. We pray over those as a staff every week, and there are many inside of our congregation who pray over those prayer requests. And if you want it to be private, we pray over those privately as a staff and elders. But if you want to share that prayer request with others to be in prayer over, you can check that public info box. And again, a lot of people pray through those. And so we would love to know how we can be praying for you all and how we can walk alongside you all in whatever step of faith you are in. And again, as we go through this morning, we're talking about envy and the temptation, the distraction that envy can bring inside of our lives. And so what I wanted to do this morning is we'll take some time and then join inside of a song. But we'll take some time to pray over those around us, those who are nearby us. You may not know them. You may not know what's going on inside of their lives. You may not even know their name. I would encourage you to take some time to find out what their name is after the service. But we want to be intentional. I think that one of the ways that we can combat envy is through a recognition of desiring blessing upon others. A few weeks back when Jeff was talking about pride, he mentioned in his sermon that sometimes it is very easy for us to mourn with those who are mourning, but sometimes it can be more difficult for us to rejoice with those who are rejoicing because sometimes we want that inside of our lives. Sometimes we desire these great things to happen inside of our lives, and we see the good that's happening in others, and we can become envious. And so we're going to take some time. We'll just do this. You guys can do this silently as we go, and we'll have some music in the background as we pray over those around us and those who come to heart, come to our hearts and minds as we're praying good intentions and blessing over those around us, blessing from the Lord and good health and good life, good marriages, good families. And so we'll take some time to pray over those around us and those that come to mind during this time. So if you would, take some time in prayer right now. Heavenly Father, help us to be people who desire the best for those around us. Help us to remove all envy in our lives. To recognize that you have given us all that we need. That you are always with us. What a blessing it is that we have you in our lives. For all the hard times and for all the good times. When sometimes we are in want, but you provide what we need. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Would you stand as we sing this next song? Here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by and I help my Lord, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God, he to rescue from danger, interpose his precious blood. Oh, the grace of greater devil, daily I'm constrained to wait. Let thy grace, Lord, like a my wandering heart to dream. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Use my heart, Lord, take and seal it. Seal it for thy good to come. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it. Seal it for thy good. Here's my heart, take and seal, seal it for thy good to come. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. summer and winter, springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above. Provided us with all that we need. Help us as we learn about this envy today, and help us to remember that you provide. As shown throughout Exodus and throughout the Old Testament, you are a God who provides for his people. As we've learned about through Jesus, you provided a way for us to be in a relationship with you, in your presence, once again because of his righteousness. As we go into a time of communion, help us to remember the Son, the one and only Son that you provided for us as a ransom for many. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
In a minute, I'm going to be looking at a couple of passages from Mark. Prior to that, I Googled the word envy, and come to find out there's 62 different synonyms or antonyms for that word. So that's a very broad area. And then there's a definition that Jeff has on his notes in the bulletin. But basically, in a nutshell, envy means you got something I want. So I'm going to do what I can to get, or whatever. And it starts out in the New Testament the Old Testament, with Cain and Abel. Cain killed Abel because he was jealous or envious of his gift was accepted by God and his wasn't. It's one of the Ten Commandments. Thou shalt not covet thy husband's or thy friend's wife. Covetous. And the thing of it is, it's a daily thing. We do it all the time. Man, that's a nice looking car out there in the parking lot. I wish I had that car. Man, look at that house. Isn't that nice? Well, I wish I could afford that house. Like I said, we do it every day, unending, unmercifully. And it's just one of those things, one of those sins we just don't think about. And it is a sin because it's wrong to do. But looking at Mark, I'm going to look at a couple examples here of some things that the disciples did that really didn't please Jesus. First one is in chapter 10, verses 35 through 44. And this is a request that's made by two of his disciples, the sons of Zebedee. You guys know anything about the sons of Zebedee? They're also called the sons of thunder. And there's a reason for that. But anyway, starting in verse 35, then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to him. Teacher, they said, we want you to do for us whatever we ask. What do you want me to do for you, he asked. They replied, that one of us sit at your right and the other at your left in your glory. Wow. But Jesus said, we don't know what you're asking. Can you drink the cup I drink or be baptized with the baptism I'm baptized with? You can, they answered. Jesus said to them, you will drink the cup I drink and be baptized with the baptism I'm baptized with. But to sit at my right or left is not for me to grant. These places belong to those for whom they have been prepared. When the ten heard this, they became indignant with James and John. Another time is when they're having a time of communion together. Then came the day of unleavened bread on which the Passover lamb had been sacrificed. Jesus sent Peter and John saying, go and make preparations for us to eat the Passover. They asked, where do you want us to prepare for it? They asked. He replied, as you enter the city, a man carrying a jar of water will greet you. Follow him to the house that he enters and say to the owner of the house, the teacher asks, where is the guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples? He will show you a large upper room, all furnished, and make preparations there. So they left and found things Jesus had told them, and as they prepared the Passover, when the hour came, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table. And he said to them, I have eagerly desired to eat the Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat again with you until it becomes fulfilled in the kingdom of God. After taking a cup, he gave thanks and said, take this and divide among you. For I tell you, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And he took the bread, he gave thanks and broke it, and he gave it to them saying, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is a new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you, but the hand of the man who is going to betray me is with me on the table. The Son of Man will go as has been decreed, but woe to the man who betrays him. They began to question among themselves, which of them it might be who would do this. Also, a dispute arose among them as to which of them was considered to be the greatest. So we're back to the greatest thing. And Jesus said to them, the kings of the Gentiles lord over them, and those who exercise authority over them call themselves benefactors. But you are not to be like that. Instead, the greatest among you should be like the youngest, and the one who rules like the one who serves. For he who is greater, the one who is at the table, at the one who serves. Is it not the one who is at the table? But I am among you as one who serves. You are those who have stood by me in my trials. And I confer on you a kingdom, just as my Father confers one on me, so that you may eat and drink at my table, my kingdom, and sit on my thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Simon, Simon, Satan has asked you to sift you as wheat, but I've prayed for you, Simon, that your faith may not be failed. And when you have turned back, strengthen your brothers. Let's pray. Father, we're so grateful we could be here this morning. They will partake of this gift that you've given to us. And Father, let us not do it out of envious hearts, but do it out of love for you, love for our brothers, love for those round about us. Take that envy from our hearts, remove it to sin that's there, Father, and may truly we trust and turn to you. We thank you for the bread and the blood, the sacrifice that was made. And Father, forgive us and be with us this day in our lives and this week forever. We ask this in your Son's name, Jesus. Amen.
few years ago, Tim Tebow came to Cincinnati and was speaking at a leadership initiative at Cincinnati Christian University. And my respect for Tim Tebow is centered not so much on his prowess as a Heisman Trophy winning college quarterback turned NFL quarterback, as much as it's based on his Christian example of integrity, his courage to do the right thing, no matter what opposition faced, and his tender displays of compassion to the overlooked and disadvantaged of society. So I determined that if I had the chance there with Tim Tebow, that I would ask him to wear one of our BCC mission statement bearing wristbands in a photo with me. So I did have that opportunity, and can we throw that photo up if it's on here and ready? It's not. So I want you to picture Tim Tebow standing beside me, and he's wearing one of our wristbands, holding it up, and it was very visible in the picture. So I'll attach that in the newsletter this week, so you can actually visualize it. So I hope Tim is still wearing his wristband with that message to love God, love people, impact the world. This very popular Christian NFL football player has a huge following of fans, both for his on-the-field and off-the-field accomplishments. And with that attention comes a number of detractors of Tebow. And I'm convinced that many oppose him simply out of envy for his many successes. And that sin of envy is this fatal distraction that we're going to study about today. Last Monday night at the Men for Christ rally, I was sitting beside Doug Haldeman at the table. I was enjoying a piece of pecan pie. I don't know which one of you is responsible, but it was very good. And as we were eating, he said, "Wow, did you hear that guy singing upstairs?" I go, "Yeah." I said, "Steve really has a good voice." The song leader, Steve Kerr. I said, he traveled with a national singing group, and he goes, "Wow." He goes, "I envy his voice." I said, "Doug, have I got a message for you this Sunday?" So he's not here this morning. If the recent topics of pride or anger haven't addressed areas of personal struggles in your life yet, then don't worry, we still have more sins to be dealt with, five more in the seven deadly sins. We still have envy, laziness, lust, gluttony, and greed. And I'm sure one or more of them will resonate with your own personal areas of temptation and challenge. I like this definition of envy. Envy's being sad about another's opportunity or success, or being glad about another's misfortune or failure. So let's look at the causes of envy. And there are several, but one is, I think, coming from self-esteem issues. We see the sin of envy manifest itself in the very first person ever born. Cain envied Abel's sacrifice. We read about it in Genesis chapter 4, beginning in verse 1. Excuse me. It says, "Adam lay with his wife Eve. She became pregnant and gave birth to Cain. She said, 'With the help of the Lord, I've brought forth a man.' And later she gave birth to his brother Abel. Now Abel kept flocks and Cain worked the soil. In the course of time, Cain brought some of the fruits of the soil as an offering to the Lord." He was giving a gift back to God. "But Abel brought the fat portions from some of the firstborn of his flock. The Lord looked with favor on Abel and his offering, but on Cain and his offering, he did not look with favor. So Cain was very angry, and his face was downcast. Then the Lord said to Cain, 'Why are you so angry? Why is your face downcast? If you do what is right, will you not be accepted?' And his gift wasn't in line with what God had asked. He was out of step with God's will. And says, God warns him, but if you do not do what is right, sin is crouching at your door. That's a vivid image. It sounds like a tiger ready to spring. It desires to have you, but you must master it. He said, right now you're really vulnerable to temptation. Cain, don't do the wrong thing. Sin is trying to seize your heart. But Cain said to his brother Abel, let's go out in the field. Hey, let's take a walk. It's a nice day. Let's go out in the field together. And while they were out in the field, Cain attacked his brother Abel and killed him. We read about it later in the book of Genesis. Joseph's brothers envied Joseph's coat. Now, beginning in verse 3 of Genesis 37, now Israel, that's another name for Jacob, the father, loved Joseph more than any of his other sons. And whenever there's favoritism in a family, that creates a very dangerous dynamic. Because he had been born to him in his old age, and so he made a richly ornamented robe for him. When his brothers saw that their father loved him more than any of them, they hated him, and they could not speak a kind word to him. Joseph had a dream, and when he told it to his brothers, hey guys, I had this crazy dream last night. He explained it to them. They hated him all the more. He said to them, listen to the dream I had. We were binding sheaves of grain out in the fields. We were out working in the crops, and suddenly my sheaf rose and stood upright while yours all gathered around mine and bowed down to it. His brothers could see the symbolism of that, said, do you intend to reign over us? Will you actually rule us? Oh, even in your dreams, you tick us off. And they hated him all the more because of his dream and what he said. Then dropping down to verse 17, so Joseph went after his brothers and found them near Dothan. He was taking supplies to them where they were out tending the flocks. They saw him in the distance, and before he reached them, they planned to kill him. Here comes the dreamer, they said to each other. Come now, let's kill him and throw him in one of these cisterns and say that a ferocious animal devoured him. Then we'll see what comes of his dreams. Here comes Dream Boy now. Let's kill him. And envy produces hatred. In some cases, it leads to murder. In the New Testament, in Matthew chapter 5, Jesus taught that hatred, this mental murder, was spiritually as damning as to physically take the life of another by murder. The older brother envied the prodigal. We read that in Luke 15, beginning in verse 25. Meanwhile, the older brother was in the field, and when he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and said, hey, what's going on? Sounds like, you know, we're having a festival or something. I've been out working for Dad, and I come back, and it's like a big party. He said, your brother's come home, the prodigal son who had been gone. He said, your father has killed the fattened calf because he's come back safe and sound. And the older brother became angry. He refused to go in. Well, I'm not going in there. This is ridiculous. We don't need to celebrate and have a party for him. He answered his father, look, all these years I've been slaving for you. I've never disobeyed your orders. Probably an exaggeration. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours who squandered your property with prostitutes comes home, well, you kill the fattened calf for him. My son, the father said, you are always with me and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and he's alive again. He was lost, but now he's found. you know, nothing the older son had was diminished or taken away from him. But because of his envy, he was robbed of his joy and his ability to enjoy all that he always had freely at his disposal. I think that's what the writer of Proverbs meant in Proverbs 14, verse 30. A heart at peace gives life to the body, but envy rots the bones. James 3:16, for where you have envy and selfish ambition, there you find disorder and every evil practice. And so one of the causes can be self-esteem. I think another cause for envy is just this active discontent, this failure to appreciate and value what one has. Discontent because someone else has something newer, nicer, better, bigger, and you find yourself unable to enjoy what you have. Have you ever been happy about your 40-inch TV screen until you go to a friend's house and they have a 66-inch TV screen and suddenly yours isn't appealing? I love the story about the woman whose husband was missing, and she and her neighbor went to the police department to file a missing person report. And so I said, all right, give me a little description of your husband, ma'am. He got out the clipboard and some notes were being jotted down. She said, well, he's tall and handsome, has flowing blonde hair, and he treats me and the kids great. I said, all right, we'll get right on it, see if we can find him. Well, her neighbor and she walked out to the car, and her neighbor said, what a whopper. You know your husband is short and bald. He's average. He's a grouch toward you and the kids. She goes, yeah, but who wants him back? Well, sometimes envy causes us to whine, if only, and wish for the blessing that another has. It can sound like this. If only my husband was more understanding like Stan is. Or if only my wife exercised and had a figure like Sheila. Or if only my kids got straight A's like the Vanderbilt's kids, Reginald and Victoria. Or if only my parents were cool like Blaze and Sunshine. If only we lived in a house like the Johnsons. If only I could have a career like she has. If only I could be a stay-at-home mom like she is. My favorite movie is Bill Murray's comedy classic, What About Bob? In the movie, if you remember that, there's an aging couple, the Gutmans, and they have saved for a lifetime to buy their dream home on Lake Winnipesaukee, New Hampshire. They're enraged when a successful psychologist, played by Richard Dreyfuss, swooped in with a big pile of money and bought our dream home right out from under us, as they described it. Later in the movie, when the house catches fire and burns to the ground, they feel strangely vindicated, and they cheer as it is being destroyed before their eyes. Envy shouts, if I can't have it, then I don't want anyone else to have it. You remember the account in 1 Kings chapter 3 when wise Solomon was approached by two distraught mothers and was asked to arbitrate and settle a dispute for them? Verse 16 says, now two prostitutes came to the king and stood before him. And one of them said, my lord, this woman and I live in the same house, and I had a baby while she was there with me. And the third day after my child was born, this woman also had a baby, and we were alone. There was no one in the house but the two of us. And during the night, this woman's son died because she lay on him. So she got up in the middle of the night and she took my son from my side while I, your servant, was asleep. She put him by her breast and put her dead son by my breast. The next morning, when I got up to nurse my son, he was dead. But I looked at him more closely in the morning light, and I saw this wasn't the son that I had born. The other woman said, "No, the living one is my son, the dead one is yours." And the first woman insisted, "No, the dead one is yours, the living one is mine." And so they argued before the king. And Solomon said, "This one says, 'My son is alive and your son is dead,' while this one says, 'No, your son is dead and mine is alive.' Bring me a sword." They brought a sword to the king. He gave the order, "Cut the living child in two and give half to one and half to the other." And the woman whose son was alive was filled with compassion for her son. She said to the king, "Please, Lord, give her the living baby. Don't kill him." The other said, "Neither I nor you shall have him. Cut him in half." Then the king gave his ruling. "Give the living baby to the first woman. Do not kill him. She is the mother." When all Israel heard the verdict that the king had given, they held the king in awe, because they saw that he had wisdom from God to administer justice. You know, today, mothers with little children can be tempted to envy those women who can get pregnant with ease, or who are cute when pregnant, or who have easy pregnancies. "No, I never had any morning sickness, and no, I never needed an epidural, or no, I never got any stretch marks, and I magically lost the weight I put on, and no, I've never had a colicky baby." And active discontent can creep into our lives and form envy. After my first semester at CCU, it was announced that there was a new policy about to be implemented for the children of the CCU faculty members. My dad was the dean of the grad school, and this good fortune would mean that as an administrator's kid, I could have a free collegiate experience. No tuition, rent-free housing in the dorm, a completely free meal plan in the cafeteria, free textbooks. You get the idea. It was the Christian church equivalent of an Amish barn raising. The only problem was that my dad was leaving his position at CCU on January 1st when that went into motion. He was taking a different role of ministry to become the editor of Christian Standard magazine. And intellectually, I understood that that would have a greater opportunity to influence more people for the kingdom. But at that time, it was creating a little tension for me. Initially, my disappointment was greater than my joy for my friend's good fortune. And because of the timing of the transition in this new policy made it extra tough. I just found it a bit tougher to accept the overall good of the big picture, and I briefly focused on my loss more than the fact that my friends had been generously given the equivalent of a 4-year full-ride scholarship to the college and grad school. Today, looking back, I'm grateful that I didn't get that. I am glad that I worked multiple jobs to put myself through college, and I gained great life experiences from each job, whether that was landscaping, working at the downtown YMCA, whether that was at the factory job at the bookbindery, whether it was my weekend preaching ministry, whether it was being a driver's ed instructor for Bick's Driving School, where I taught 400 16-year-olds to drive, which really improved my prayer life. But Titus chapter 3, verse 3 says, at one time we too were foolish, disobedient, deceived, enslaved by all kinds of passions and pleasures. We lived in malice and envy, being hated and hating one another. But when the kindness and love of God, our Savior, appeared, He saved us. Not because of righteous things that we had done, but because of His mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit. Actually, Paul is saying He saved us in spite of what we have done, not because of what we have done. Sometimes we think, if I do enough good things, God will notice that and he'll be pleased. And in His grace, He forgives us in spite of what we have done. And we serve Him and do good deeds because we want to say thank you, not in an effort to earn or achieve the salvation He's already made available to us. God sent His Son to save us. That washing of rebirth alludes to the soul cleansing that takes place at baptism when we are immersed and when we receive the Holy Spirit. It's a surrender where we give God the control and discover that life is the best, the most fulfilling when we are serving Him and not ourselves. There's a third cause of envy, and that's questioning God. Romans chapter 1, watch for that word to pop up again in this list. Verse 28, furthermore, since they did not think it worthwhile to retain the knowledge of God, He gave them over to a depraved mind to do what ought not to be done. They've become filled with every kind of wickedness, evil, greed, and depravity. They are full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, and malice. They are gossips, slanderers, God-haters, insolent, arrogant, and boastful. They invent ways of doing evil. They disobey their parents. They are senseless, faithless, heartless, ruthless. Although they know God's righteous decree that those who do such things deserve death, they not only continue to do these very things, but also approve of those who practice them. If we are envying, then basically we are questioning God's wisdom or His distribution of blessings. Presumptively, we are second-guessing or asserting that we know more than God. So questioning God, just like a low self-esteem or an active discontent, causes envy. And we can all see flickers of envy that can appear in our lives. So how do we overcome these tendencies? Let me give you three quick cures before we close for envy. The first cure is simply to recognize envy. Recovery doesn't begin until an alcoholic can admit, I am an alcoholic. I have a drinking problem. 1 Samuel chapter 18, we see the envy that possessed King Saul. It says in verse 8, Saul was very angry. This refrain galled him. So they were having this big pep rally out in the streets, and he's been a successful military guy, and now his success is being overshadowed. It's being eclipsed by David, his successor, this understudy. And the women in the streets are creating a song. Saul has killed his thousands, But David has tens of thousands. Let's hear it for David. Woo, woo, woo. He's going, man, I hate that guy, you know? And so it says, what more can he get but the kingdom? And from that time on, Saul kept a jealous eye on David. It changed their relationship because of envy. He didn't look at his trusted friend who had the soothing music that helped him with his depression and his struggles. He now was jealous of him and wanted him eliminated. So listen to what happened next. Verse 10, the next day an evil spirit from God came forcefully upon Saul. And he was prophesying in his house while David was playing the harp as he usually did. Saul had a spear in his hand and he hurled it, saying to himself, I'll pin David to the wall. But David eluded him twice. Saul was afraid of David because the Lord was with David but had left Saul. Saul was once a vibrant, godly monarch. But after his brush with envy, he was never the same emotionally. He became consumed with his envy of his understudy. He overlooked the truth that the first step to overcoming envy is recognizing envy. He never sought the cure that follows admitting that struggle. That's the first thing. If you're working through envy in your life, is to say, you know, I find myself envious of that person, that other person. The second cure is to practice gratitude and contentment. Most of our envy springs out of the fact that we don't value or appreciate what we have. We're discontent. We're not grateful. Someone said, I used to complain that I had no shoes until I met a man who had no feet. Be grateful. I've shared with you before about our pet hamster, Houdini, named because of his similar skills as an escape artist. And he turned up missing just a few days after we had gotten him. And we suddenly began to detect an aroma coming up through the ductwork. And we called the furnace people and said, is there a way you can just kind of take out a panel and find our little missing rodent and you know, get him out of there? And I think we think he's died down there. And they said, no, we couldn't isolate that. Our advice to you is just turn up the heat and you'll kind of, you know, toast him out that way. Okay. And, you know, as we look back on Houdini's brief life, he had everything. I mean, this little guy was spoiled rotten. He was loaded. I mean, he had all these tubes to play in. He had this ball to roll around on the floor. He had a bed of fresh shavings, had a clean source of water, an abundance of food. He didn't have to go out and hunt or gather. I mean, he had it made. But it wasn't enough. He wanted more. And his quest for greener pastures ended in a fatal furnace accident. Think about James 1:17. It reminds us, every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. Remember, who is the true source of everything good? The final way to be cured of envy involves a redistribution and taking a focus off of self and being sure it's placed on God. And so that final thing is to pursue God. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 1. Therefore, rid yourselves of all malice, all deceit, all hypocrisy, envy, there's that word again, slander of every kind, like newborn babies crave pure spiritual milk. When a newborn baby is hungry, you know it. When he or she is craving milk, they make you aware of that. He said, have that same intensity as a hungry newborn for spiritual things, for God's teaching, the milk of the word, so that you may grow up in your salvation now that you have tasted that the Lord is good. Craig Massey said, two beasts beat within my breast. The one is foul, the other blessed. The one I love, the one I hate, but the one I feed will dominate. And so that's the challenge for us, to pursue God with grateful hearts and not to miss out on all he's done for us. Well, let me close with this poem by Dot Aaron. It's called The World Is Mine. Today upon a bus, I saw a lovely girl with golden hair. I envied her. She seemed so glad. I wished I were as fair. When suddenly she rose to leave, I saw her hobble down the aisle. She had one leg and wore a crutch, and as she passed, a smile. Oh God, forgive me when I whine. I have two legs. The world is mine. And then I stopped to buy some sweets. The lad who sold them had such charm. I talked with him. He seemed so glad. If I were late, would do no harm. And as I left, he said to me, you've been so kind. It's nice to talk with folks like you. You see, he said, I'm blind. Oh God, forgive me when I whine. I have two eyes. The world is mine. Later, walking down the street, I saw a child with eyes of blue. He stood and watched the others play and seemed to know not what to do. I stopped a moment and then I said, why don't you join the others, dear? He looked ahead without a word, and then I knew he couldn't hear. Oh God, forgive me when I whine. I have two ears. The world is mine. With legs to take me where I would go, with eyes to see the sunset's glow, with ears to hear what I would know. Oh God, forgive me when I whine. I'm blessed indeed. The world is mine. Would you stand and pray with me? Dear God, help us to appreciate what we have and not to want what someone else has. Help us to overcome this discontent from the evil one and not be victims of it this week, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
This is my Father's word. Into my listening ear, all nature sings and around me rings the music of the Spirit. This is my Father's word. Me.
Our study of the seven fatal distractions next week, and appreciate your attention this morning. And those who are worshiping with us online, we're grateful for you tuning in, being a part of our service today. You can drop your connection cards and your offerings in the wooden offering box there at the double doors, and you can always give a secure gift anytime, 24/7 at our website. Let's pray. Dear God, just point out the blind spots to us where we may have envy still in existence in our lives, and may that change this week, because we've looked into your word today and been reminded of how to rid ourselves of that habit. So help us to carry out those marching orders this week, we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Darkest of friends.